Hallelujah. New beginnings. Let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's begin new beginnings with a word of prayer. Our Father, thank you so much for this glorious day. And as it snows outside, Father, we thank you for this fine shelter that we can be in today. I do pray that you keep everyone as we return. Father, just as it snows, we will be reminded. Some of us will be walking out and making new tracks that's never been made before. Even in the snow, perhaps that's even applicable to our life today, Father, as we leave here today, going in a new direction, going in a new steps, Father, that you've placed before us. We're expectant, Father, of what you are going to do with your people. We just ask your Spirit to come down and dwell here and fill this place right now. Help us be pleasing in your sight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, new beginning. So, just kind of a recap. Dave was talking about it already with the sukkah moving around. So, that would be kind of typical of maybe Jacob's tent. Okay? And you can see there's not a lot of grass growing there. And so they're getting hungry. And they hear about, hey, there's food in Egypt, right? So, and what we're picking up in the Exodus story in the Torah cycle is actually just before the plagues begin. So the need for the Exodus has come, and they're getting ready to build up for that. But right now, so as at 70 souls or 75 souls, people, they discuss how many souls there actually were. But they went to Egypt for a reason. Here we go. One of those reasons was for food. Another one was security, safety. These are things that they found in Goshen. And another one was families, right? So they joined back with Joseph and his family. This is similar to us. We found ourselves alone. At least, if not everybody here has had the opportunity to find yourself alone, like we're the only ones who believe this way. You don't know what you've missed. But whatever the case may be, if you have felt that, I hope it wasn't for long. All right, because it's not a pleasant thing. But we heard about, hey, there's other people who believe, and there's food there. It's something, hey, we might even have this. Look at this. There's food there. We can learn Torah. We can learn about our Creator. And there's safety there. We're not going to be judged for how we want to worship. And then there's family, other people that share in the same belief system. And then we get to Goshen, or when they got to Goshen, then they had the water and they were able to feed their flocks and they had safety. And what happened when they were there for that number of time? What's one thing that happened from 75 souls to whatever? Did they shrink in size? They multiplied. They multiplied greatly to the point in which they finally felt a need to leave then, but they had served a purpose in Goshen, and it was time to leave. And the Father provided a way. This is stuff we already know, but I really like her expression. She's one of my favorites right there. Not sure if that water's going to hold. How many of us have felt that way? All right. So then they're in the Exodus. So basically, this is us right now. This is where we are. David was kind of touching on it too, is that the Father opened the door and we have moved forward, and now we are in our temporary dwelling place. So this is where we are. This is our encampment right now, today. And these are our tribes, our families around that. The pillar of smoke is there because they've already dedicated it, right? And he filled that place. So, and we don't know how long this is. And like David said, maybe we're on our second encampment of that. We're hoping that we're not going to be 40 years here. But, you know, if the Father can do good things here in 40 years, I'm all for it. Whatever his plan is. But we know it's a temporary dwelling place, and it's not the promised land. That's what GMD2 is going to be. Again, we have, $40,000 or something building towards that. And people are continuing to give to it because other people have the vision, and they see that eventually we're not going to have to set up tables and chairs every time. We can nail the suckers to the floor if we want to. And we will be able to have a place for us to flourish and grow even greater if we wanted to. So hallelujah. But what a joy it is to be able to come here today. I'm just thrilled. Okay, new beginnings. Did I call it new beginnings because of what Pope Gregory says? No. When Melanie and I first started on this faith journey, the internet was something new. Actually, it was no internet when we started on it, but soon after there was the internet. And our favorite website at the time was called thepopeisadope.com. Do you remember that? And we get on there and we just laugh and chuckle. It's like, look at this. This is so funny. And it just described all the things that that Catholicism had said that leaked into Christianity that we didn't know we had adopted. So anyway, but this still is, like Johnny said, this is a civil calendar that we operate on today. We're working by Yahweh's calendar primarily, but I got the day off a couple days ago because of pagan holiday or whatever. That's, I guess not for, because of New Year's Day. So, you know, I take this stuff seriously. I don't refer to, you might know me, I don't refer to the days of the month. For this purpose, I'll say it today. January is from the Greek god of called Janus, which is a two-headed god that looks into the past and looks into the future. It's like, no, I don't go for that stuff. So I refer to it as the first month of the year. But whatever. Just the same, we are operating today a civil calendar, and that's fine. Is that why we called it New Beginnings? No. Something more important than that, and that is 22 years ago we started on this journey. A lot of us, we picked up on the way, and then 6 years ago we moved into the basement. That was GMD 1, Go Make Disciples 1. And that 6 years ago and 8 months is actually, I think, last week, the celebration of that. And now we're here. So this is something rare. Moving to the basement was after 16 years. Moving here is after another 6 years. So this is something I think that every one of us should be able, that's here today, should be able to remember this day. Let's forever remember this day. Not just because we're here, but because he wants to do something new and special in all of us. And let's move forward with that. The number 8. What does number 8 mean, basically, in Hebrew thought? New beginnings. Yes, it does. The title kind of gave that away. I just assumed you knew that, though. New beginnings. Some of the things I've learned about the number 8. Yahweh's all about new beginnings. I know that because he's done it in my own life. But if you include the Sabbath day, there are 8 commanded moed in Scripture that are commanded himself. So you have the 7 feasts, and then you have, it starts off with Sabbath in the description. So that's 8, which is a reference to new beginnings. Yeshua showed himself 8 times after his resurrection from the dead. I didn't know that, but when I double-checked it, I said, yeah, that's true. 8 times he showed himself. There's a reason why he did that. And then the other one was the New Testament writers, they believe, were 8 men. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, James, Peter, Jude, and Paul. That's interesting. So the number 8 new beginnings is being reaffirmed. In Shavuot, these are things we're familiar with, but Shavuot is, what is it, a celebration of? What's another name for Shavuot? Feast of Weeks. How many weeks? 7 weeks. How many days in a week? 7. So you have 7 sevens. Was that enough for Shavuot to be proclaimed? What did you need? 1 more day, which is, again, another 8. It's another 8, if you will. The first day of the week is always also the 8th day. And I believe that's when he sent his spirit. That's when Shavuot was. Feast of Tabernacles, again, in here. 7 days festival with an 8th last day called the last great day. And the word there that describes it as a solemn assembly says, because it talks about 7 days, then the last day is a solemn assembly. That word is atzerah. and I can't roll my tongue. I can't do that, David. You do it really well, but you roll in there somewhere. Etzerah, and that's rooted in the word etzer, meaning restrain, stop, detain, or my favorite word, arrest. Something about the Feast of Tabernacles, the last great day, which is also the last of the commanded feast days, the very last one, which is pointing to forever, right? It's pointing to eternity with him. Something's going to be arrested forever. And I happen to think it's the enemy that will be bound up and put in confinement. Hallelujah for that. Another eight. What do you think is happening there based on the script picture? Circumcision, yeah. And circumcision is not just a picture of the fleshly circumcision, but it always happens on the eighth day. But Scripture in Romans talks about, for he is not a Jew or an Israelite who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh, but he is an Israelite or a Jew who is one inwardly. And then it says, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit. So it's an internal thing. New beginnings internally in our heart and in our spirit. It's a spiritual thing. So then let's talk about new beginnings. Let's talk about the first beginning. In the beginning, Yah. And Yah said, let there be light. And there was light. This is not new to us. We know the order in which these go. But we had the first day being separation of light from darkness, right? Day two, separation again. Waters above from waters below. Day three, God gathered the seas and the dry land. He separated those. These are all separations. And now he's made the sun and the moon to be signs for sacred times. I was going to look into the Hebrew word for made versus created, but I didn't get to it. There's a task for you to do in your first Hebrew lesson. But it's cool because before he even creates man, he's already created the way in which the timekeeper, and way in which he's going to be able to keep. So he's already got the feast days figured out. Before he's created man, he's already got Passover figured out. That there's going to be a need for Passover. Oh my goodness, love it. Then the birds and the fish and then man, right? Oh, the animals and then man. So day six, seventh day is today, right? Actually, is it almost dark? So we're still lingering on the last bit of the seventh day here. This is his plan. But what happens when we finish all days one through seven? Are we supposed to just forget about it? Just becomes a blur one week after another? Or is there more for us to learn there? And that's kind of what I want to talk about today. Because I think the pattern is this. When we've had Shabbat, when we've sat at his feet, when we've worshiped him, when we've enjoyed his presence, and fellowship with one another, and learn things and talk together and pray together, I think that helps us then to do this tomorrow. Tomorrow, with what we've learned, let's start separating again. Let's separate the light from the darkness. The first thing you have to do when we separate light from darkness sounds easy. But you have to identify which is which. That's not as easy as it sounds. You know, this is pretty clear. This is pretty clear. These are lights and stuff. But the enemy has a way to mask himself as light. But it's about separation once again. And we're talking about new beginnings today. So I'm going to suggest that maybe we need to reevaluate, because this is an eighth day. This is a new beginning. What it takes to separate ourselves from things that we need to. So let me see what I was doing with this. A question is to you today, what are you going to do with the time you have left? Now, let me just ask a question. I did a little research on my own. We started keeping Sabbath when I was 33, I think. And it worked out to about, from today I'm 55, that we've kept about 1,144 Sabbaths. And they've, every one of them been sweet. But there had been 2,860 Sabbaths since I had breathed my first breath. I missed out on a bunch of Sabbaths. I don't want to miss out on one more. I want to be in his presence. I want to be doing what he's asked us to do. What are we going to do with the time left? Let me ask you a question. Mike Friesner, I'll ask you. You don't know what I'm going to ask, do you? So, how much time has gone by since you breathed your first? Oh, no, since you were born. Yep. 66 years. How much time do you have left that you haven't lived? No idea is right. We don't know. How many of us this year, raise your hand if you have, how many of this year has lost somebody that you loved? Got okay, in the last, thank you. In the last 365 days, thereabouts. And even acquaintances that you know have gone. We don't know how much time we have left. So what does that mean? What's that look like? Well, let's talk a little bit about this. I know for me, I've shared this before, but I've already outlived my grandfather. My grandfather passed away at 49. And that's what killed him. And I have that picture. I didn't take that picture, but I looked hard for that picture because I still go hunting in his old woods, and I still find half blue ribbon cans on the ground, scattered all over in the woods, where he would pitch them so Grandma wouldn't find them. And it still makes me sad. Not just because I didn't get to know him very well, but because when I was around him, he was drunk. And matter of fact, the only time I've ever drank alcohol is one time that he tricked me. And he put some in a glass at one of our family get-togethers, says, here, have this. And I took a drink and I didn't like it, but that's the only time I've ever drank alcohol. I think Melanie could say the same. Not that we're gloating, but I learned later in life never to touch this stuff because it pretty much destroyed my mom's family. And I lost my grandpa, and I saw the damage that it did. But more importantly, I also knew how easily I could be swayed into this area because of family heritage. So I never got involved in it, and that's not because I'm strong. That's because I'm weak. I intentionally stayed away from this because I think I have a weakness there. So the Father gave me strength in other areas. So this was at age 8, 9 years old that I was aware of this. At age 12, I was a believer now at this point, and I had to make another choice. And this choice was concerning my best friend. I had a really good friend in school. I try to walk on this side this time. I had a really good friend in school, and I didn't want to give up this friend, but I also had church friends that I valued a great deal. And this one friend of mine, I had decided, well, I'm either going to have to give up this friend or I'm going to witness to him. I'm going to see if maybe he'll respond to the call. And maybe he'll want to come and hang out with me and my church friends. So we went and had a camping adventure. And he had no idea what I had up my sleeve. But I shared the gospel with him. And he responded. And we became even better friends. And he was the best man at my wedding. And my first son, his middle name is after Matt. Matthew, Devin Matthew Bradley Schwartz. And he was a good friend of Melanie as well. But I had made a choice concerning my friends. And I would already put it on the, like a, what do you call it? A fleece. I put a fleece out that if he didn't respond, that's going to have to probably end his friendship. And I didn't know what that meant. But the father responded, and I was grateful. And he was too. So we can't choose our family members. Especially children, you can't choose your parents. But we can and we should choose our friends. Can and we should. I'll talk more about that later. But before we do, I want to let's look at this. So we're talking about new beginnings. Here's a new beginning. Is it? Can anybody identify that seed? That's a bean. I don't know what kind. Looks like a kidney bean, doesn't it? Well, this is what it looks like in, as it grows here. Oh, okay. Okay, this is where it's supposed to have some sound. This is a good test. It's not important to have sound here, but if maybe Casey can work on that. You can see the days down here. But pay attention to what's happening. I'm going to ask you some questions. Missed the end. Da-dun-dun-dun. What did you notice about that? Now, it was over 25 days, and they didn't take it all the way to the point in which it was producing the flowers and the fruit or vegetables, but what did you notice in this? Mike?
It did. It did.
That was interesting. Roots are important. Right. Oh, that's good. That's good. A lot of great ideas. Thank you. And it went on and it showed that these roots never stopped growing. They kept getting finer and finer and finer and different things. But the taproot was first, like Mike pointed out. So where did it get its energy? Where did this plant get its energy to begin with? Good soil, but there was something where the taproot came out of. It was from the seed itself. So there was enough nutrition in the seed to begin the journey. And it said, the most important thing I need to do right now is put down a root. Put down a root. What does that root do for the plant? Feeds it? Feeds it what? Minerals and water, yeah. So everything it needs to produce the plant. So I love it. This is Yahweh's creation. This is his design. Well, this might be a hybrid. Or most likely is. GMO for all we know. But the idea is still going to be the same. So yeah. And that's kind of true here today. I thought about sending out a mass email to invite a lot of people that maybe comes to Shavuot or something to today. And I realized, you know what, we really need to get rooted here first. You know, don't go ahead and invite people that you feel led to invite. But let's put some roots down too. Let's figure things out a little bit. No, we don't have to perfect it, but let's figure it out so that we can better then be prepared, not just for this, but the ultimate goal, to bear more seed, right? To bear more seed. To hold up the plant. So we're heading down. Well, you can't just push on this, can you? All right. But I love this too, because as these came out, they kept getting finer and finer and finer. And it made me think, spiritually speaking, of ourselves or of myself, that, you know, let's not just look for water over here and nutrients here, but let's keep looking all over. Let's network. They talk about in finance that you need to have multiple streams of income. I think it's true in spiritual speaking too. We need to have multiple ways to receive his instruction and his joy and his testing. if you will. And that might be Bible reading. It might be listening in the car to the right radio stations. It might be coming to Sabbath meetings. It might be participating on the worship team or dance. It might be praying with your children when you put them to bed at night. Multiple ways in which we will be able to sustain the plant. All right, this next picture may seem a little bit odd. It seemed odd to me, but I prayed about it, and this is what the Father showed me. Sorry. Who knows what that is? Tim? A manure spreader! I said, Father, are you sure you want me to show a manure spreader? He said, yeah, not just one. I want you to show more than one. So you'll get your fill of them today. Manure. Manure can represent that which we want to leave behind, or the animals want to leave behind, or if you're a pig, you want to wallow in it. But even our llamas, I remember we had llamas for a while, and it was the weirdest thing. Llamas are so stupid. I have no value for llamas. But they had one thing smarter than sheep. When they had to use the bathroom, they picked a latrine, and they went over there and said, this is where we're going to drop our load. And they made a load of it. They made a hill of it. But they kept the pasture clean. The sheep, you know, they just wandered around, whatever. But I thought that was interesting. Manure can represent to us that in which we want to leave behind, which can be failures, disappointments, injury or pain, even handicaps. Plants are really cool. For the most part, they inhale what we exhale, and they uptake what we get rid of. So manure becomes something in which this is something that we want to leave behind, and plants are going, oh, that's perfect, thank you. That's why they're putting it on the field. So, things I was thinking about as I was preparing this. Yeah, I might say, oh, so you failed, huh? You've come to a place where you say that you failed in something, whatever that might be. I've failed. And he says, good. The fact that you recognize that you failed suggests that you know that there was a requirement. And you fell below that. Now, who put the requirement there? Maybe he did. Maybe we did. Maybe our parents did. Maybe the law did. But we failed. He says, good, I can use that. The fact that you failed and that you recognize it, that's the beginning. Yeah, he says, you've been disappointed by others? He doesn't rejoice in that. But he can use that too. Because he says, I will never fail you. He says, you've been hurt, you've been injured, you've endured pain. He says, I felt your pain too. I can use that as well. Here's a plant growing in the manure. I believe that Yahweh says, it's this pain that I will grow in you empathy. Now, I've told you this story before. Millie and I, our house, our wood boiler quit on us. No, we didn't have a wood boiler. We had a heat outside. Our chimney failed. We were heating with wood, and our chimney collapsed internally, and we weren't able to heat anymore. And it was that really cold winter. I don't remember which one it was, but it was a cold winter, and we were heating with a fireplace, and I'm grateful we had a fireplace. It wasn't this kind, but I slept right in front of the fireplace with a stack of wood right here, and we put sheets on the doors to keep the heat in one room, and I shoveled that in there like I was feeding a train all night long. And that's how I got through the winter. And yet we weren't warm. It was still cool in the house. We learned empathy. That's the word. I keep wanting to say apathy. It's not apathy. That's the opposite. Empathy. And that year, we started helping at a homeless shelter. Because she said, and because I'm dull and I'm slow to understand, but she said, how do people living in cardboard boxes get by? Because we couldn't do it. We were living in this house and we were freezing. So because of that, we learned, and we could see for the first time how others must be feeling. So he can use pain and hardship to teach us empathy that we might not learn otherwise. So we can be grateful for that. What about disappointment? He says, in disappointment, I can teach you contentment. And I can also teach you to trust me with your self-worth, not others. Don't ever put your self-worth in somebody else's hands. You know, as children, yes, you with your parents, they will help and instruct you and teach you. But they will always tell you, you're my child, which should be enough self-worth by itself. But don't a young man, a young woman, take your self-worth and hand it to somebody you just met. Because they will crumple that up, throw it away like it's worth nothing, and leave you hurting and wondering if life is worth living. That is a ploy of the enemy. That young man, that young woman, does not deserve your self-worth. Nor should they be trusted with it. Only he can be trusted. What about failure and brokenness? Failure and brokenness, that's what I will grow within you. Patience, steadfastness, vision, and hope. Is there anybody here that's experienced a failure that you feel you're willing to share, that you were able to grow from? I know we all failed, but is there anyone here that's willing to share a short testimony to that regard? New building, same people. You shouldn't be afraid. I know I've had my share of failures. All right. Let's move on. But he will use our failures and our brokenness. Quite frankly, that's where we're pliable in his hands. I was going to get some Play-Doh today and have the children make some things, but it didn't work out for me. We were busy. But the point being that the Father he will mold us and he will shape us if we allow it and into the proper vessel to do whatever his bidding is. Okay, so let's move on if I can. Uh-oh. I've only got a few slides left, but I'm froze up, so I'm going to start that again. I apologize. There was a time, and I'll share it with you, about my own failure, and that was with that my friend Matt. Let's see if I can go to the next slide while this is thinking about it. Yeah. The Father won him over to himself, and I was grateful for that because I didn't want to lose this friend. So I was young, I was 12, and he then said, because his life has been changed, he then said, hey, this is great. I want to tell some more friends. Let's go tell some more friends. And I said, no, 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 no. It's just me and you, pal. Yeah, I failed. And I dampened that joy in his heart. And that was a failure of mine that I never repeated again. I learned from it. But that was a sad moment. And I confess that because none of you are willing to. So, and I've sought forgiveness in that. You know. And there's been, by the way, one of our friends, co-friends, ended up becoming a pastor. So it wasn't all lost. It wasn't by my doing, though. I don't think it was by Matt's, but it could have been. All right. Speaking of the taskmasters then, Scripture says this, you are not alone. Even Paul says in Romans 7, 15 through 20, for what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. Of course not. Why would we do what we're supposed to do? And we discipline our children, right? But what I hate, because I despise, it goes against my king. It goes against his ways. That's what I do. And then he goes on to say, what a wretched man I am. Right? Okay, I can identify with that. And he wrote a good part of the Bible. So we're not alone. But we might say, I want to be free from the taskmaster. So this guy is here. He's not enjoying his day in the sun. What can taskmasters look like? The ones that the Father shared with me today was a critical spirit or a critical tongue. Having its way with us. Not that we're the taskmaster, but it's ruling over us, not allowing us to worship Him the way we want to worship. Set my people free. We might be the critical person that is always bringing the darkness to a situation. Well, yeah, you know, Eeyore, he was a critical spirit. Has anyone ever mentioned or called you an Eeyore before? Then that's something you battle with, a critical spirit and a critical tongue. Because it also can be manifested by withholding praise. Not just causing damage, but withholding praise. Withholding love. When's the last time we told our loved ones, every last one of them, that we love them? It's something to think about. Put the whip away. You're free. Love on them. What do we have to lose? A spirit of depression. That's something that is a hard taskmaster on us. And I don't have all the answers there. I know it's real. Sometimes all they see is darkness about them. And there's avenues to help that. But first, let's seek the Father and let's seek Him through prayer. But that's something serious too. And then also a spirit of anxiety. You know, an anxious person wants to know, okay, let me put it this way. An anxious person, I'm sure there was several of them in Israel, when they went into the desert and said, okay, what are we going to eat? Moses. He said, well, here's some manna for today. No. I want to know what we're going to eat all next week. See, I get groceries once a month, and I stock up so I know what we're going to eat, and I budget it all out, and I have enough food so I don't have to worry about what I'm going to eat, what I'm going to feed my family. He didn't change the circumstances and says, okay, you're right, you've got a weakness there, so therefore, I'm going to give you enough manna for a month. He said, deal with it. You're going to get enough manna for today, and on preparation day, you get enough for 2 days. But you're going to have to deal with your anxiety. Then there's taskmasters of addictions, alcohol, pornography, drugs. Drugs might be over the counter or under the counter. TV, soap operas. When I was about 12, again, I had a summer. It was before I was useful to Dad. So I didn't get the chance to work with him. My brother Doug got to work with Dad. And I was stuck at home with Mom and my little brother. And we'd go mow the yard or something. But every day, about 11:30, if I remember right, Mom would sit down and watch, what was it? It was Young and the Restless. That's what it was. Nikki and Victor, and I could name you half the people. Yeah, kid. And so I'd go in and have lunch, and I'd sit down with Mom. And it's like, Before I knew it, it's like, oh, what's going on with Victor? Oh, man, I missed the soaps today. By the end of summer, I was like, are you kidding me? And then 40 years later, there's still Nikki at I don't know if she's in the shows anymore, but she's in the tabloids still, and Victor, and he's like, old man, and they're still a thing. It's like, this stuff's addictive. So it can happen to anybody. Social media. Whew. My brother gives me a hard time because I don't get involved in that, but I'm a sucker for TV soap, so I'd be a sucker for that, probably. Gaming. Shopping even can be an addiction. And then bad friendships, that can be an addiction too. That can be something that brings us down. You know, I talked to you about how I try to choose good friends. It's not easy, and it's hard. And I remember my parents, when they first became saved, they went through a hard time because they had drinking friends. And because my parents drank. And they had to make, when they first became saved, they said, man, they tried to change their friends, and their friends wouldn't change. So they had to change their friends. And for the first, their first friends was each other. They didn't have any friends. And they weren't constant churchgoers, so they had to go for a time with no friends. And they chose that before they chose friends that would bring them down or bring them back to their addictions. Friends that were bad for them. And they chose to go alone before they did that. And I still value that and respect that today. Because in our friendships, yes, we should bring the light. We can be the light to our friends. We might be the person that's going to bring them to salvation. But if we try that and attempt that, and the result is, no, they're bringing more darkness into our lives, it's time to walk away. And ask the Father to give us new friends. What about unforgiveness? That is a taskmaster. That's one of the most vicious of taskmasters. He carries a big whip. Because we might think, hey, unforgiveness, I'm not going to forgive, doesn't deserve it. Well, we might talk more about that later. Let's move on. So this is our Exodus. Today, this is a day of new beginnings. And I want to suggest to you, we just crossed over. Right now, not just sit in a hill today, but today you have the opportunity to cross over. Be on the safe side of the Red Sea and see these taskmasters perish, become powerless in our lives. In Jewish thought, they say, could very well have happened because is Yahweh's arm too short? No. They said that each Israelite saw their very one taskmaster dead on the seashore. I'm just going to go up and see who's there. Well, that's George. He's the one that whipped me 1,000 times. Push him in a little further. He's powerless. He will not chase me down. He is gone. Hallelujah. So this is our Exodus. This is our chance for an Exodus. And I ask you again, what are you going to do with the time you have left? Because we're back to that statement. We're almost done here. We're back to that statement then. In expectation, something's going to happen. Cause and effect. Moses finished all the work. Let me ask you a question. Did he finish all the work? Was he ever given more work to do? Moses? After this? They're just setting out. He had Israel to lead for the next 40 years. 39, 38 years. So what work did he have to do? What does it say? He finished all the work. What does that mean? The task he was given for that time, in that moment, in that place. The Father just said, don't worry about the future. I'm just talking about today. I need you to be obedient to me today. Then, because by your obedience, not only are you blessed, but oh my goodness, all Israel was blessed. By oh my goodness, are we still blessed today? Hallelujah, cause and effect. I'm going to run this in the background. I'll turn it down a little bit. Yeah. Do you desire to commune with Yahweh like this? I know I do. I know I do. Do you want him to fill your tabernacle? Because this is just a picture of us. This is you. That's you. That's me. And he wants to commune like this with us. Tabernacle, temporary dwelling place. This is a temporary dwelling place. The stage is set. Today is 1-1-2022. Today is the day that we begin a new place with Sid in the Hill. The stage has been set. There will never be another moment exactly like today. Let's finish the work. What work, you say? I'm talking about the work in front of you right now. What work has Yahweh shown you today? If you've been listening to this and you've been thinking, boy, yeah, this my son or my daughter or my husband needs to hear this, you're not listening. This isn't about them. This is about you. This is about me. This is about making a change that's going to affect all these people and more. I want everything that he has for me, for my family. Let's finish this work. Let's start a new beginning together today. The adversary says, no, let's not go there yet. That's what we're going to do. We're going to just pray together. We're going to pray together, okay? And I'm hoping that you can be saying these words in your own heart. I'm not going to ask people to raise their hand. I'm not going to ask people to come stand up. This all might happen in the future. You shouldn't trust me. This is new beginnings. Anything could happen here at this place. I'm willing to try new things. I'm not stuck in my ways too much. But I do want to give you the opportunity today. And if you make a change today, I want you to tell somebody today. Because today is the day. So I'm just going to say a word of prayer. And if this identifies with you at all, by all means, join with me in prayer. Father, I know I have failed. Father, I know I need more of you. Father, I want your presence in my life, but I haven't done all the work. I haven't prepared like I need to. Prepare my heart. Cleanse my rooms. You show me what is light and what is darkness, and I will separate them. I want a new beginning. I want a new beginning today. I want to be your child, and I want to serve your people. So if you've set the stage today for me, for such a time as this, I accept that. And I just invite you into my heart, change me, and make me new. I want to celebrate every Sabbath forevermore in your presence. I want to embrace your gifts. I want to accept with joy the path that you have before me. The challenges, the tests that I've shirked, I embrace. The hurts that I've held hostage, I surrender. My hopes and dreams I put in your hands. Give me a clean heart that I might hear your voice and know your voice so I can have this kind of relationship. That I would shine so brightly like a city in a hill, like a tabernacle of flame, that people would be drawn to you. Not to me, but to you. What has changed me? Make me a house of the Lord.
as you inhabit. May we sup together continually. Replace my poor friendships, Father, with good friendships. Even if it means having no friends, Father, I'd rather do that than continue in friendships that drag me down or drag me away from you. If I've got addictions, Father, that is dragging me away from you, and I've put them on the altar where you belong, I've taken you off your altar, set you down, and put some substance up there, some TV program, forgive me. And please take your place in the throne of my heart. And I hope that you've been able to identify with some of this, because I want everyone to have a new beginning. I want a new beginning. The Father has trusted us and trusted us and believed in us that He's opened this door. I'm not trustworthy, Father. You see something in me and in all of us that we don't see in ourselves. We know you're wise and true and smarter than we are. So you know something we don't. Shocker. Thank you for that. Vote of confidence. Help us to be good stewards of what you've provided for us. Amen and amen. Now that I'm going to have us say something together. I'm going to say what this is kind of like what we used to call in church years and years ago. Responsive reading. That's going back to my old Mennonite days. But the adversary says, and you're going to say this. This is what you're going to say. You're going to say, especially if you said this prayer, but let's all say it together. You're going to say, no, this is the house of the Lord. That's what you're going to say. So the adversary says, here, let's get drunk or high. The adversary says, here is an R-rated movie. It's really good. Here, now come on, harbor that unforgiveness and anger. They deserve it. Here, trust and obey all that the woke community says you must do. Here, you don't have to put up with this from your spouse. You should just divorce like I did. Here, join in the pagan revelry. People will think you're strange if you do not. Okay, now you're going to change what you're saying. And you're going to say, yes, this is the house of the Lord, okay? The Ruach, Yahweh, the Spirit, Yeshua says, here, I have a gift for you. Here, I have a task for you. Here, I stand at the door of your heart. May I enter? Thank you. Let's pray. In closing. The Father says, this is a message He gave me today. We talked about this being a new beginning. Day one, separating light from darkness. That's what we're committing to do today. But He says, that's just the beginning. There's six more days of creation, my child. I have more creating for you to do. You have not created your best song yet. You have not created your best idea yet. You have not created your best dance yet. You have not created your best message yet. You have not had your best laugh yet. You have not created your best moment yet. But let there be life in your light. Let there be light in your life so that you can better see to create. Let's begin to see ourselves anew, to see ourselves as the house of the Lord, the house of Yahweh. He's chosen this house. He's chosen your house. He wants to abide there. He wants to live there. He wants a flashlight to see every room. He wants to illuminate it better than any LED light that there can be. And he wants to inhabit your place. Father, inhabit our home, our hearts. Inhabit us. Shine your light in us, that we might have joy as Israel when they saw his presence. They were awestruck. May we be awestruck. Knock me silly. Amen and amen.
Sing praise, 'cause we were the blessed.